did we talk about osteoporosis, osteomalacia, all those, or we just did, we did osteomalacia, okay. So we had to do osteoporosis yet?
No, we have.
Okay. Thank you all. I've never had stuff stay with me this long, it's crazy. And I went to the doctor on Friday, I still had, I had a temp, like,
Are you drinking enough fluids?
Probably not, do anything else. I'm a bad person. So are you feeling duties?
What?
Made up work.
Did you see what those sticklers are?
Did we do five?
Yeah.
And gout?
No.
She's been stapling it together, but she actually needs to start. We need to start on Diane's table. Okay. Yeah, she's actually been making it.
It was right the way it was.
We did arthritis, right? We did arthritis and lupus.
Yes.
All right. All right. I just can't get it together. I'm pretty good for that. All right. So, we're going to leave off talking about osteoporosis. Now, these in your, on your information, it says you're going to read those on your own. I don't ask you questions about these diseases because they are actually pretty rare. So I'm going to just go over them kind of quick, mainly because it's like one of those things you don't, I mean, it does happen. And that's, every time I say you'll never see it, and when you see it, but... It's not something that you're going to see a lot in patients, truly, but it doesn't happen that often. This one actually probably may even occur more than Tetanus disease when you actually got to think about what's going on with patients. But osteomalacia, anytime you see malacia on something, it means softening. Because tracheomalacia is the same thing. So what it is a softening of bone. It usually happens because a person's been immobile for a long time, kind of thing. So it's not something, you see it as one of those bone diseases, but it truly is a softening of a bone. So it's a metabolic disease that happens to bone that makes it soft. Paget's disease is also a metabolic bone disease that happens in patients. And what both of these will cause demineralization, and the major thing you see associated with it is pathologic fractures. So those are things you monitor the patient for. But I'm not going to ask you those on a test because those are not things that happen a lot. Remember, we try to, thinking about this NCLEX test plan, the things that they ask you most often are the diseases that you're going to see in the first year of working. This is not something that you're likely going to see in the first year of working. I've been a nurse for 34 years and I've never had a patient with Paget's disease. So I know it happens, but to say somebody actually has it, no. I have had osteomalacia, and that's usually for patients who've been usually trauma patients, that kind of thing, who've been immobilized for a long time, and they end up, you know, you rehab them, that kind of stuff, and it's been a slow recovery. Those are the people that you should have that. So yes, you can read that on your own if you don't want to know, but I ain't gonna ask you no questions. Thank you. All right. The other things up here, I will ask you about mail because those are things we see. The other thing about it is that what's kind of, it's not exciting, kind of new, but one of the things that we see as an indicator of patients, as you know, we always end up talking back at the heart, because that's my favorite line, is that gout is one of those things you see with patients who have cardiovascular events. So it's been researched and shown that patients who have high uric acid levels have high, that have incidence of gout also have higher incidence of coronary artery disease and cardiovascular events. So that's why it's a big deal now. And that a lot of times you'll see doctors actually even add that to your screenings for your annual visits. Not long are we just doing just chemistry panel, but you're gonna see a vitamin D level done, you're gonna see a uric acid level done on the patient, and then you see the CRP. Because all of those things, when we look at patients and we're looking at the incidence of coronary artery disease, those are things that you see that are elevated. So we wanna talk about that. Osteoporosis, of course, tends to happen in women, so we see that a lot, especially postmenopausal women. So because our area has a lot of old women in it, including me, that's one of the things we have to kind of look at that goes along with that. And then we have our chronic low back pain, something that we see as a issue of deconditioning, but also because people have injuries, you know, so not doing good body maintenance, the issue that happens with that. But that chronicity piece is why we have a lot of people that are using opiates and why we have so many opiates that are using this clinical category. So we'll talk about these and then of course get ready to talk about our stuff for tomorrow, as long as my voice will last, because that's the thing, so it goes and comes. So this it was really bad the last week. All right, so osteoporosis is also a demineralization of bone that tends to happen in women more than men, and in those women that it happens in, it tends to be fair women, very petite in stature, happens more in Caucasian and women of Asian descent. So those are the people you see most often when you think about risk factors associated with osteoporosis. Although it can happen to anyone, including men, that's the thing that people don't think about, because we do focus so much on women and osteoporosis, we don't think about, oh yeah, men can have osteoporosis too. But it tends to happen more in postmenopausal women. The other thing that you see it in as well is that the women tend to be small in size. So it's very rare for a woman who's heavier to actually have osteoporosis, but it can happen. One of those reasons is the more weight you have on, although it causes problems with your knees and your joints, the weight on your bones actually makes them stronger. So usually it's something rare that you see a person who's heavy that has osteoporosis, but it can also happen in those patients too. So you're always thinking about, for yourself, the high index of suspicion is thinking about a woman who's postmenopausal, who has not continued estrogen therapy, those types of things, that's going to be your person most at risk. If she's very small in stature, small weight, you know, she's very light, you know, those little, that's my niece, but she probably weighs a buck when she weighs 100 pounds. So people who are smaller, those types of things you worry about. But it tends to happen later in life. But you can have women who develop osteoporosis early. A lot of those that actually do develop it earlier, when you go back and look at their history, they also have had a hysterectomy. So that whole piece about estrogen protecting us is really something that's really true. But what happens with osteoporosis is that the bone demineralizes and it becomes more porous. That kind of goes with the name. So you lose, you have an increased turnover in bone, so you lose it. And so what happens is that bone is then made almost like a Swiss cheese appearance. Not quite the same as you see with multiple myeloma, because that also does the same kind of thing, but it's a different process. With multiple myeloma, it's the issue with the plasma cells and bone marrow. When you're talking about patient has osteoporosis, it's the periosteum, all that kind of is involved in the bone matrix is the problem. So what happens is that bone becomes more porous, meaning that you lose the density in the bone, therefore it's more adept at being fractured. So that's what you worry about with patients. They have pathologic fractures, and a lot of times when you look at a woman, you think about osteoporosis, as she gets older, she has a lot of low back pain, those types of things going on because she's actually fracturing the bones in her spine. So you actually see their stature decrease. So you know, a woman who's 5'6", when she's, you know, 20, 30 years old, is now, you know, 5'4". Some of that is because of kyphosis, because of the, you know, the bend over thing that's going on. But a lot of it is from compression fractures. And so they can actually have pain associated with that. When a nerve root gets caught, then they can have that pain associated with that. But the big thing we worry about with them, of course, is pathologic fractures. And that means that things that would normally not cause a person to have a bone fracture happen in a woman who has osteoporosis. So a relatively small amount of trauma can produce pathologic fractures. You know, because we think about, it really takes a lot of force to break a bone. If you've ever seen, I don't know if your instructors are getting you into surgery where you actually see surgical procedures done. Sometimes you'll see the force that it takes for them to break, you know, if they have some kind of appliance that they have to take out and redo something with bone, and see the hammers and stuff that kind of go into doing that. It makes you weak in the knees almost to see how much pressure it takes to do that. With patients who have osteoporosis, relatively small things, you know, ground level fall, meaning you're just standing up, fall down just because you tripped over something, can produce a pathologic fracture. So those are the kind of things that we look for. We look for that age of the woman, or the man, because we can see it both sides. But you see that y'all end up having sometimes bone pain associated with it. But pathologic fractures are the things we see most often. What we do once we actually find that, and you know, we do screening after you get to a certain age. We actually do DEXA screening to check your bone density. So they'll actually do that. That's when women will go in. You go into a screening machine, and it does your hip and your ankle. Those are the two bones they mainly look at and see about the density of your bones. Once they do, and that's something that you do pretty much when a woman turns about 60, that's when the first screening is done. They can do it before that if there's a family history or there's a patient maybe have a pathologic fracture, and now we need to look and see what's going on with it. So if they, once they do that, then they're gonna say, well, this is what the prescriptions that we can give for building that bone matrix are medications. So, and then of course, you can actually gradually add exercise with weight bearing. So you actually want to actually put weights on your ankles and on your legs, that kind of thing, to actually increase the weight, because weight is what's going to actually make the bone stronger. You're also going to give calcium, vitamin D. Those are things that help for women that can, you know, the big thing you worry about, especially when people are outside and they're older, is that yes, the sun helps you actually manufacture vitamin D and all that kind of thing. But sunshine also is something that can be cancerous, considering that as a person gets older, the risk of skin cancer is greater. So if you do tell a person to go outside because vitamin D is something that is going to be helped by sunshine, always have to tell them to wear sunscreen as well. So always remember that piece kind of goes along with the teaching. Yes, I want you to go outside because it's going to help you with vitamin D, but I also need you to help cover yourself, so they need to use a sunscreen to do that. But we can also take minerals over the counter that have vitamin C and D with them. So I'm assuming calcium and vitamin D. So those things that you can actually have as a preparation. But a lot of times people will tell you, oh, the pills are huge. Because if you ever see caltrates and that kind of thing, the pills are humongous. So just depending on what the patient likes, do different formulations. And the simple thing you can do is actually Tums, because Tums is just calcium. That's all it is. And people can chew those, that makes it a lot easier. But as far as the vitamin D preparations, those are usually pills they need to swallow. So calcium supplementation is something you give to the patient. Calcium with D, because they usually put those together that they're gonna take. But then you get into the other pills that we're gonna use as far as treating osteoporosis with patients. And those are medications like Oliva. Is one of the big ones that you see that we give to patients, all right? But just know that these particular drugs, the big thing as far as patients taking them is that, and this is something that's probably come out in the last few years, that the effect of taking the medication actually lasts far longer than the dosage or prescription that the patient takes. So there are some doctors that say, you know, depending on how old this person is, because the risk for your stomach, because it's GI stuff you have to worry about, these big guys. So that's a big teaching piece, but will actually be on the exam. So these types of drugs that you give for bone mineralization, the patient has to be able to sit upright out of bed for at least an hour after the medication is administered. It is not optional. It has to be done. They have such an erosive effect on the esophagus and the stomach that you can have patients that it actually eats through and can have perforations. So it's not optional that they can do this. So if you have a patient that says, no, I can't get up, then you wait till they get up to give the medication. Or if you have a patient that says, no, I can't get up at all, then they need to talk about using some other drugs for the person. Because that's how serious it can be. You have a patient who goes right through, I mean, their esophagus will just erode till they can actually have bleeding. And then, of course, you're bleeding through there every time. That's like a perforation. You gotta worry about peritonitis. And then you gotta worry about the issue of hypovolemia because this patient is bleeding. So it is not optional. They have to get up out of bed and be up for an hour after this medication is administered. You always try to give it with food as well. That's the other thing. Yeah.
Those are the ones that are once a week, right?
No, initially they're always, when you see patients, they're always gonna take these initially every day. Because what you're trying to do is get that bone matrix built up. The thing that you see, and the research is saying now, is that the effect of the drug can last as much as 9 years. If you can get a person to take it continuously for about 2 to 3 years, that the medication or the effect on bone tissue can last that long. So that's the thing that's going on right now about dosing. You'll see some people, if they've been taking it routinely for a while, actually take it less later. But when they first do it, they take it every day. So that's one of those things we talk about, evidence-based practice. That's one of the things that you see that's real. Because that, truly, when you start going to school and you take research classes, you go, oh my God, this is so boring, I can't deal with it. But one of the things that kind of comes from that is that, yes, when you see how we change what we do as far as nursing practice go, it all comes from research. So somebody has to get an idea to think about, oh, is this something we can do for a patient? But the big thing about this one was we kept seeing all these women who ended up needing to have surgery because they ended up perforating a bowel of some type. So the stomach or the esophagus, one of those that would happen. And then you'd have people that end up with a whole lot of complications associated with that. So that's one of the major teaching points you want to make sure you do with this. It's bisphosphonates, or it's the class of drugs these are. But that's what you want to do is make sure the patient can sit upright out of bed for at least an hour after the medication is administered. So there's no reclining in the chair. You need to just actually be able to sit upright. And they need to understand this. But the good thing is that what we're seeing is that the effect of the medication can last for a long time after. But GI stuff is a major concern about what goes with that.
What's like the pathway behind that? Because it'll sit in a certain spot? Or?
It's real caustic. I mean, even though it's a pill you can take and it's enteric coated, one of the things that it acts, I mean, it does what it's supposed to do, but one of the things that it does as well is actually can erode the stomach. So that's what they worry about. It's very kind of corrosive to that. Almost like NSAIDs are, but this one is like NSAIDs on crack, kind of thing if you're thinking about the effect of what you want. So a lot of times, even if the person isn't taking anything for GERD and that kind of stuff, they add it because of this. And you may even see as much as, you know, because depending on how bad it is, if you got a person with really bad osteoporosis who's fracturing a lot kind of thing, you may end up seeing a person actually end up on the cycloprotective agents like Carafate and that sort of stuff.
So laying down will cause this.
It'll cause even worse reflux. I mean, because it...
They won't allow... They want you to sit up because they want...
They want you to sit up because they want the medication to actually proceed down the GI tract. The farther down it gets, the better. You know, when you think about when it actually starts to peel away the enteric
parts. Right.
But that's what the big GI stuff is what you really worry about. They do also have a nasal spray calcitonin you can use. But that one also can cause ulcerations in the nose, so if you're giving that to a patient, make sure they alternate sides. So if they're going to put in the right side today, you have to put on the left side tomorrow. Because all of them are caustic in that way, but they work and do what they're supposed to do. But you don't see that one used as often because of that reason, because you have people that have to get their septum repaired. That's how bad it can be. So it's just bad stuff. The major thing you want people to do is prevention. So even if a woman has never exercised in her life kind of thing, you want people in their 30s and 40s to actually do weight-bearing exercises. Even if they just put a 5-pound weight and walk with that, that's something that helps. So you just want to make sure they do that. And then, of course, they will redo the DEXA scan after the fact to see whether or not there's some improvement of what's going on. And it's just, it's strange sometimes because you can have people that don't, we don't really know what's going on until we end up doing the scan to see what's happening. When I fractured my foot the first time, I was just like, doctor told me that the force of what, because I didn't have anything that broke the periosteum, which is the outside of the bone. That wasn't the problem, it was all on the inside. And when I looked at my x-ray, I told him, how is that happening? Because I know when it was white, and that shouldn't be that way. Bone is actually like gray when you look at it on x-ray. And so he said, well, that's you, what happened? And I said, because he said the force of what happened in my foot was like dropping a gallon can of beans from 6 feet on top of my foot. And I said, well, I would have remembered that. So no, that didn't happen. But the second time I did it, almost the same week, a year later. And so after that, I had to get a DEXA scan. And so it's so funny because my doctors and I have this strange relationship kind of thing. Because we sit there and talk about stuff. And I told him, I said, I'm fat. So I don't have no osteoporosis. And he goes, well, yeah, but you have a fracture 2 years in a row. And I said, well, I still don't have osteoporosis. How much you want to bet? So we did go to bed. And he said, well, I don't know what's wrong with you after I went back. Because he told me I might have to wear a bone stimulator if it happens again. And I'm like, are you serious? And then I'm thinking that's going to be some kind of contraption, that's going to look space age, and I'm going to die. That's all I was thinking about. But it's not bad. So you can show me after the fact, but I had to make up all this stuff in my head. But so I've actually already had my bone scan probably 15 years before I would have had it. But they do sometimes, especially if people have fractures that are weird, like mine was, they will do them earlier to see if there's something that's going on. Because most of the time, bone things, unless it's something that causes you a fracture causes pain. That's what I had, but I didn't associate that with anything going on as far as demineralization goes. And so you don't have other people thinking the same thing either. And that could be what's happening. All my, you know, the minerals in my bone are gone and they're fracturing, that kind of thing. So they will do it earlier if there's something that's strange that happens just to see what's going on. And though I didn't have any of those other things either, because that was the next thing he said, what
Malaysia.
Shut up. I don't have any of that. But he's a crazy guy for it. But that's the big thing. You have to make sure patients understand that whole thing about taking their medication. Then with gout. Gout is considered a disease that is has to do with uric acid. And so it's kind of a combination. It's a metabolic connective tissue arthritic kind of thing going on, because gout ends up being multi-system, mainly because uric acid levels build up in the blood, and the major issue, they tend to come and deposit themselves in the joint spaces, and it's usually the great toe where you see patients present with complaints of gout. So they'll tell you the great toe on my foot is enlarged, it's swollen, it's red, it's painful. First thing you think is gout. If the person didn't have any injury to that foot, because you know you always have to think about, did they hit themselves? Did they drop that can of beans that they forgot about off from 6 feet on their foot and now they have pain? Or did this person just present with that? But the other thing is, even though the great toe is what's most often the presenting symptom, it can affect other joints as well. So you can have people talking about pain in their hands, their knees, shoulders, all that. So just know that the uric acid itself actually deposits itself in the joint spaces. So that's the major thing you see with it. So now the thing about it is there's no rhyme or reason about why gout can happen, because it can happen to anyone. But like I said, the thing we're seeing now is that more and more people who have elevated uric acid levels also have cardiovascular events. So it's something we test for now in patients who present with chest pain, those types of things. So you'll see doctors actually order a uric acid level. But the thing about it is it's because your body can't process purines, which are in foods that you eat. Okay, so it's something that's contained in organ meats. So if you eat a lot of, nobody eats a lot of liver. And I said that one time, and one student said, yes, I love it. I'm like, I eat it, but it's like, to eat it all the time. She's like, yeah, I can eat that 3-4 days a week. I'm like, what is wrong with you? Unless you're a vampire, maybe you crave it or something, I don't know. But if there are certain foods that have high purines, and it's usually organ meats are one of the big things, but it also happens and other things as well, but your body can't process it, therefore your uric acid level goes up. So how we do that, get rid of it, of course, is that we can do medications, and we have to change what you eat, because because it's one of those things you have to look at dietary things that you tell patients about their eating. But mainly, you're going to see doctors actually manage it with medication. Now, when it's an acute episode of gout, we use the really high dose or the high potency anti-inflammatory, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So this one of the times you usually see Indocin. Remember I told you Indocin you don't see a lot. It's only used for certain things. Gout is one of them. We also use it for pericarditis, mainly because Indocin has the highest amount of anti-inflammatory effect in any of the drug NSAIDs that you can use. But that's also why you can only use it for a short time. Because that same issue that you have with stomachs with Boniva, you would have the same issue that you have taking Indocin for long periods of time. So you never use it for more than 5 days. And usually what doctors do is give it for the first 3 days. So the first 3 days around the clock, you're going to see it given. So they'll take it in the morning, afternoon, and evening. So you're going to see that kind of dosing done for 3 days. Max would be 5. And then they're going to go on some other type of drug to control their pain. The other thing that we're going to give is allopurinol, which is a medication we give for gout. It helps to decrease the uric acid that the patient has in their bloodstream. This medication you should take with 2 to 3 liters of water per day, so a lot of forced fluids. That also is going to help decrease the uric acid level. It's almost like you're getting, you know, flushing it out of your body. Not really in that, you know, comment per se that that's the actual thing that's happening, but essentially what you have to do is you're diluting it, and that's what you want to do. So allopurinol is the medication you give associated with that. We just go ahead and put the Indocin up there too, which would be the anti-inflammatory use first.